And we're off. Everyone and welcome. We have Lizzie in the middle, as we know as Heidi Ho, and Cheryl, my moderatress, is on the end, who will be monitoring your comments in the live chat, and she will bring up the interesting ones to our attention so we can talk about them. Let me just have a look in live chat to see who's here. Daniel, Tracy. Two Daniels. Miss MacGyver. Kay. Right. Soul Sister. Right. Well, so we're going to start tonight with a short video of. Oh, come on. Something. It won't click.
Basically shows a lot of the pictures of the area, right?
Everyone's mind and those that haven't. Those are new to the case, actually, they can have a look around and see, familiarise yourself with the surroundings. And here it comes.
A great video, Maureen.
Oh, thank you.
Right. I think it introduces everybody to the case.
It does.
The visual.
Yeah, it's important to see the surroundings because you'll realise how important as we go along with the story. That is over to you now.
And what a story. Yeah. Welcome to everybody, and particularly those that have never been in, studying the case. And that's why we're trying to start basically from the beginning, but it's such a widespread case that it's going to be intertwined right the way through. Before I start, I want to say, after I did a short little episode last week, and to be honest, I'd actually thought, well, everybody can get a bit of Lizzie overload, so I wasn't going to do another one for a while. But I was persuaded. I wasn't persuaded. I learned about Kim and, oh golly, is it Jim? Who were huge supporters, and they made the difference. Once I realized how much they wanted to see the Madeline case, I decided, okay, we're going to start. And we're going to do it, if we can, every Saturday. And apart from me, hopefully we'll have some guests. And it will probably shock you with some of the details that I discovered while I was doing my research. I spent several years, and this was not in public. I took the files. I took all the statements. I separated them into timelines for everybody and into hour or quarter of an hour tables so I could compare exactly what each of the tapas nine were doing and saying at any one time. And that was huge, because what it told me was there were discrepancies that started on the Tuesday morning. Now, everybody's idea of the case is that they arrived on the Saturday, on the Sunday, they went to breakfast in the morning and spent the day. We don't know much about the Monday, but on the Tuesday, Madeline had a tennis lesson. And on the Wednesday, it was raining, so the tennis lessons that all the tapas were joining in with was rained out. And then, of course, we get to the Thursday where little Madeline disappeared. And I say disappeared because a lot of people might not realize that from what I have found from the files is that she wasn't abducted. And I think a lot of people that actually read the files realize that. Now, the files, the police files, there's 40,000 of them. So I don't think anybody's actually read them all. But we were fortunate, because they were in Portuguese, that the Maddie Case Files admin, a great group, put their effort into translating pretty much all of the files that we need. And that took them 4 years. Now, they did that voluntarily. They did a superb job. And subsequent to that, all of us in the Maddie groups have never wanted to make any money from doing the case. Doesn't matter how many hours any of us put into the case. It was an unwritten rule that we didn't make any money, because they had given us everything we needed voluntarily. And anyway, so that's basically where I started. And I took the files as they were being translated. And one of the first things I did, because the statements were the first things that were translated, I took them and put them into sequence for the week. So this is what I wanted to go across for this week, is putting the statements into the daily routine of what they did, or what they claimed they did. And initially, it starts off with a holiday. And maybe, Maureen, if you could start the first video. What this I focused on my videos of not doing smart and snappy videos. They were usually about 10 minutes long, and I put as much information into them for reference. And actually, this is where it turns out well for now, because all the information for each day is in my videos. And so you don't have to go looking around the internet to try and find it. It's all right there. Everything I stand by as being what you can find in the files or interviews, books, whatever. So if you could just play this video, which shows them leaving on the plane, arriving in Faro Airport, and traveling to the resort, Praia de Luz Ocean Club. So if you could play that one, Maureen, that would be great. I think. Maureen?
Well, maybe Maureen. Yeah, the video hasn't uploaded, I'm afraid.
Okay. Well, we can hold on.
But it's just now popped up on the screen at the bottom. This might be a connection issue. And it's usually fixed for trying again. So if you want to carry on talking, I'll get this uploaded again. It only takes a couple of minutes.
Lizzie, someone in the chat asked a question. How many people were involved with translating the PJ documents?
There were several. A lot of them, unfortunately, were names which at the time I didn't recognize. The main ones were in Maddie Case files. And there were, I think, about four of the admin that did it. Kaz Lux, Joanna Murray, Sophia, and, oh golly, someone else. They were the main ones. But honestly, the effort and the work that went into that, we can never be more grateful, because if they hadn't done that, we would not be able to discuss the case at all, unless we knew Portuguese, which I don't think many of us do. So I'm really, really grateful for them. And the Maddie case files, they actually, although it was a closed group for us in the forum, they have all the information available, and it's absolutely, I will guarantee that it's factual. They would never, ever put anything in their forum that wasn't factual. So if you just, I guess if you just Google the Maddie case files, you may come up with it, or else I'll try and leave a link somewhere. But thank you to all of them for what they did. Amazing. So are we any closer with the video?
It's uploading. It is uploading, but it's a little bit slow. I mean, it's only 2.5 minutes, and it should have uploaded.
Yeah. Well, never mind. Okay, there was 9 of what we call the Tapas 9. That was Jerry and Kate McCann and their friends. There was 3 couples. Basically, there was Russell O'Brien and his partner Jane Tanner. There was David Payne and his wife Fiona Payne, and also her mother came along too. And there was also Rachel Mampilly and Matt. Matt and Rachel. So they were 4 couples altogether. Now, Russell and Jane had 2 children. They had Ella, who was their oldest daughter, and another younger child. And then David and Fiona also had 2 children, and Matt and Rachel had 1 young baby. Now, Kate and Jerry had Madeline, who was just a week away from being four, and the two twins that were, I think, about 20 months at the time. So they all came on the same day, but Russell and Jane came from London, and Matt, it came from London, and Jerry and Kate and the Paynes came from the Midlands. So they arrived a few hours after. Now, even, it doesn't sound much, but even the fact of their arrival being within the same day, and I think Jerry and Kate arrived later into the afternoon, about 3-4 o'clock. Even at that point, when they told their statements a week later, they left us realize, they said, well, with Jerry, I think he went back to the apartment. With Fiona, she said, oh, we all sat on the balcony and chatted. Kate tells us that she took Madeline down to the pool. All of them tell a different story for the hour or two prior to them all meeting up at 5 o'clock. It just didn't fit. None of it fits. And why? Now, at the time, it was just a normal holiday, but it's them covering themselves for what was to be. And what I believe was, at some point during that week, and I believe it to be Tuesday, sometime before Tuesday, something happened to Madeline. I'm not saying she died, but something happened. And Tuesday morning, there was lots of discrepancies, which you'll see in some of the videos, which I can go over later. But the discrepancies started Tuesday morning. Now, if that was a normal holiday, why would there be discrepancies? You know, the odd thing where they disagree with what they did, but no, these were major discrepancies, and that started Tuesday morning. So that's when I realized, later on, I didn't realize it straight away, that something happened to Madeline before Monday, because they had something to cover up after Tuesday morning. So actually, I think probably what I should do, if it hasn't uploaded yet, Maureen? Has it uploaded? Oh, I guess not.
It's just processing, but I don't think it's going to show, to be honest, because it's taking too long. I don't know why. Well, everything else is uploaded, okay?
No big deal. Now, what I did, I have a WordPress blog, and I did a page on the holiday as it stands, and it's something which maybe you could, if you want, you can go over. It's got the basic videos of that time, but I'll start, and maybe I'll just take from there in case my rambling confuses you. As if, Maureen, right? Okay, I'm going to start. I'm not going to directly read, but if only my mouse worked, I could probably do better. Okay, so you'll see me repeat several times about the years I spent researching the timelines and discrepancies. That isn't because I'm requiring accolades. In fact, nobody knew I was doing it at the time. I did it because it's my passion to form an opinion based on knowledge. And when asked, I cannot pull a theory out of thin air. I form my opinions based on the information I've studied in the case. And I hope that gives me credibility for members that have not had the time or opportunity to research to any extent. I base all of my videos, which I think I've got about 250, on the research and details from the files. But that being said, I never want anyone to believe something just because it's mine or anybody else's opinion. You must draw your own conclusions based on what you have confirmed to be true. And you can check everything I say. Never blindly believe anything. that is the worst thing. And it's what we try to do to give you details, provide links so you can confirm for yourself. That's really important. And after discovering some explosive information yesterday, which this was when I wrote the blog, it was time to give you an overall knowledge of the week so you could see for yourself a little of what I see, so you can maybe understand what my theories are based on. And so basically everything I discuss is from memory. There is absolutely no point in me doing bullet points or anything, because this case is so big. I think those that know the files knows how big it is, but otherwise you wouldn't. I'll try to explain some of the things that happened during the week in chronological order as I recall them from the research, so you can maybe understand why I believe something happened much earlier in the week. Everything is based on the files or facts that we know. And you can always come to us and check and ask. So on the Saturday, they arrived mid-afternoon. They went to the tapas at 5 p.m. for information about the Ocean Club and details about the humanities. From what I understand, there was a half-day creche which was included, but the second half of the day was extra. Now, this is important because initially it seems like they really were only going to use one half of the day, but because of what happened, it looks like they ended up using the whole day, which they had to pay for. But again, this is with the knowledge that something had maybe happened to Madeline and they had to deal with it. So they left and they went to the Millennium restaurant with all the children and had supper, and then came back to their apartments that evening. And that was it. Now on the Sunday, they didn't, we don't know too much about Sunday. Apparently around lunchtime, the cleaner's daughter saw them going up the steps to the Payne's apartment. And this is a moment where apparently Maddie was actually seen. And this is the last sighting of Madeline that I can find that I feel is proof that she was there. And that was the cleaner saw her, and they just come out of their apartment, and Maddie was holding some bread ready to go up to the lunchtime at the Payne's, which they were probably going to do every day because they had the biggest apartment. Now, they also went to the pool around lunchtime. It was a lovely sunny day with temperatures around 23 degrees. And that's the day that I believe the last picture was taken. So a lot of people would disagree with me, and that's fine, but that's what I believe, following from the research I've done. Now, that day, Matthew Oldfield was apparently sick and didn't go to the tapas on Sunday night. And this is what happened. Every night, they all went to the restaurant, but every night, pretty much, there was somebody missing. And that person missing is the one I believe that was actually looking after the children during the week. One person stayed behind, looked after the children. Now, there's a discrepancy that is hard to understand how it could be a discrepancy, because you either know it or you don't. And this is that he was sick, didn't go on the Sunday night, but oddly, a week later or a few days later in his statements, Russell O'Brien claimed that he went to check on Matthew and Rachel's child. Now, how could that be? You know, it's a fact, that supposed fact, that Matthew was there in his apartment, and yet Russell's saying he went to visit their child. So that stood out to me. Hold on a sec. So anyway, they dined at the restaurant that night, and the meals were included, as was the wine. There's a lot of talk about the fact that they were drunk and that on on the third when Madeline disappeared. But if you study the bill for that night, they really only had the equivalent of a few bottles between the nine of them. So I personally don't believe that they were drunk, because I think they were too intent on dealing with what they were dealing with that night, and that was creating the so-called abduction. Anyway, that's just my thoughts. So on the Monday, they all went to the Millennium for breakfast, but the McCanns didn't. They figured it was difficult walking with the twins, as they didn't have a buggy. They actually did have a buggy, but apparently they tell us they didn't. Kate played tennis every day at 9:15 to 9:15, and then Jerry played from 10:15 to 11:15. There was some speculation that the McCanns went to Sagres on the Monday, but that's never been confirmed. But there was some weird things happening Monday. We didn't hear about a lot. They didn't talk about it in their statements. They avoided it. And what I found that they tended to do was things that we know happened on one day, they actually changed it to that other day. There's a reasoning behind that, I guess. But now something may have happened with the shutters on the Sunday, because the maintenance men were called in. They came on the Tuesday. And curiously, Matthew claims to have had a problem with his blinds, but and they were in the apartment next door, but no record of having them fixed. So it's kind of weird that the shutters on Sunday or Monday, something happened. Again, this is the day when we really don't know too many details. So it's a little bit suspicious, but maybe nothing. Now then, on the Tuesday, this is when I was quite shocked at some of the things that were happening. The discrepancies started so early. And I wonder if you've got that, Maureen, the tennis one. Do you have that?
I do. Just one sec.
Okay, before you put it on, this video I did, and it highlights a lot of the discrepancies with Maddie playing tennis.
Sorry, the tennis Jane one, and one we couldn't get.
Oh.
Yeah, that's the one we couldn't get. And the one that replaced that is the one that won't upload tonight.
Okay.
I don't know whether I
streamed it. Okay, no problem. It's
playing up a little bit, StreamYard is tonight.
All these videos are on the WordPress page. So if you do want to kind of check over everything, the videos that I'm referring to here are all on that WordPress page. Now, the first thing that I noticed, because everything I was looking for was to look for proof of something that was true. And on Tuesday morning, Madeline was supposed to be playing tennis, mini tennis, which was really not tennis. It was, I think, a few of them, six or seven, came onto the court for half an hour to an hour, and were just, they were three and four. You know, they weren't actually playing tennis. Who knows? They may have had little sponge balls. I really can't find out anything confirmed about that, but it really wasn't a tennis game as such. And but what was very weird is the discrepancies started, and now they do get very confusing, is that Kate, Jane, and Rachel all claim to have been there at Maddie's mini tennis, which was Tuesday morning at 10:30. Now, Kate and Jane claim that they were there, and Jane took the picture of Maddie with the tennis balls. Kate tells us that she ran back to the apartment to get a camera, and she took the picture of Maddie with the tennis balls. And Rachel has made it absolutely confusing, because she claims it was Thursday was the mini tennis, but we'll get into that later. And they claim they were sitting with Kate before in the recreation area. Now, how can she be sitting with Kate before? Because Kate's tennis lesson was 9:15 to 10:15. They also claim that Jerry was there with them. Now, Jerry's tennis was in the court next to it, and he didn't finish until 11:15. And this was 10:30 to 11. So this was total basic lies. I mean, you don't make a... You know when Maddie's playing tennis, who's going to be there? You'll remember it. You don't claim things that are not... have no basis. So that started showing me that something was happening. Now, later on, I initially started believing that something probably happened the day before Thursday. But at one point, I got back to the point where it was Tuesday, because the tennis court coach had actually seen Maddie on the Tuesday. This is what I was trying to find out. I wasn't looking to find a day that something happened. I wanted the files to tell me. And the files at that point, later in my research, told me that if Georgina, the tennis coach, saw her, then she was there. You know, she was credible and there. It was only when I went back and scrutinized her statement that I realized she said Maddie was one of a group of children. Now, if she'd have looked at her log and it said Madeline's group, you know, or the Maddie was in the lobsters, she would just presume Maddie was there. So that wasn't proof for me that Maddie was there. And so we get back to the Tuesday. Now, there was so there's so much else. I'm getting past at lunchtime. Here's the other thing, and this will fit in with later on when I discovered how they managed, if something had happened to Maddie, how they managed to get through the week to have everybody believe she was at the creche. The creche records were discussed ad infinitum. They were so disorganized, it was hard to make use of anything. But one day, and I've said it before, I say one day, it took me 2 days to take the important information from the creche files and put them into a graphic. And I remember those 2 days thinking, oh my goodness, why am I doing this? It wasn't until a little bit later that I started looking at them that things started to pop out to me. And I saw that Russell O'Brien and Jerry pretty much most of the time arrived and left and picked up the children at the same time. Now, that they were off doing their own thing, and yet they both arrive and leave at the same time. Something was odd there. So that had me questioning it, and I'll let you know where we go. So on the Tuesday morning, at lunchtime, Jerry walked with Jez Williams, who was another guest at the Ocean Club. He played tennis with him, to pick up Madeline at lunch. Jerry made a point of telling Jez that they left the children alone. Now, that in itself, why would he be telling somebody that? If something had happened to Maddie and they decided that what they were going to do was pretend there was an abduction, do you think he told him because he wanted everybody to know that the children were left alone? In which case, if the children were left alone, then an abductor had the chance to pick them up, take Maddie. And that's why I believe on the Tuesday morning, on the Tuesday lunchtime, it's very possible that Jerry started telling everybody that they left the children alone because he wanted everybody to know that there was a... Later on, there was going to be chance of an abduction. After the lunch, Jez explained to him that the evening creche was available and that they provided blankets to bring the children home. Now, is this inspiration to Jerry about the abductor that Jane Tanner saw, you know, carrying the children and carrying the supposedly Maddie away. I don't think she had a blanket, but anyway. Now, what they did after lunch on Tuesday, they supposedly walked down to the beach, and it was a chilly day, and the twins didn't want to enter the water, but they made a point of saying they bought 5 ice creams. Now, why buy 5 ice cream? Why say that? We had ice cream. You don't say. But I think they wanted to make a point that it was 5, because there was 5 of them. Supposedly Maddie was with them. They needed everybody to know it was 5 ice creams. Now, what's really weird about this is that that day, on their return back to the creche, the kids were all going out on an ice cream trip. Now, why would that be? You know, why would it just doesn't fit with me. And on his way back, and I hope some of this might not seem important right now, but as we go through it, you can start to see how all these little things fit in. And on the way back, Jerry claims he bought sunglasses from one of the street vendors. Now, that's kind of an odd thing to say. But if you look at the fact that the last picture, he had sunglasses on. And as I've mentioned before, I believe the picture was taken on the Sunday. But by saying he didn't get his sunglasses till Tuesday, to me, that tells me the possibility that he wanted to point out that it couldn't have been any other day of the week because he didn't have sunglasses. It had to be Thursday that this picture was taken. Others may agree with me, others not, but it's always a possibility. And apparently the ice cream trip they had to pay for. I don't know whether or not they paid anything. Now, on the Tuesday, they all went to the tapas except Russell. Now, it was Matt before that didn't go. And on the Tuesday, it was Russell who stayed in his apartment because he said his youngest daughter was sick. And he also tells us about she was sick and he had to wash the sheets. Now, according to the quiz mistress who supervised the trivia quiz that night, about 9, she then joined the table until about 9:50 and says no one left the table. And as she recalled, she did not see Kate during that time and does not remember seeing David Payne. Now, this fits in with the thought that if something had happened to Maddie on the Monday, Kate would be in total grief. And so that shows that there was a possibility that Kate was not at the restaurant that night. It's not proof, but it is a possibility that she was not there. And she was, you know, obviously, if something had happened to Maddie before Tuesday, she was in grief. I mean, there is no way that she would be able to do anything. So it seems that Russell, Kate, and possibly David Payne were all missing from the table. Certainly, one of them could have been watching the children, as we mentioned before. Every day, somebody was missing. Because I don't believe for one second that they left their children alone. Now, at about 10:16 that night, and we don't know where Kate was. She could have been at the apartment. If she was seen at the tapas, it would have been there, but we believe it was probably the apartment. She starts to receive a flurry of phone calls, about 5, between 10:16 and 10:27. And then shortly after that, Mrs. Fenn, who lives in the apartment upstairs, claims to have heard crying, getting increasingly stronger with what sounded like daddy, 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 and it seemed to have come from a toddler for about an hour and a quarter until 11:45. And that, to me, I mean, the thoughts, I don't know. I don't know where that could have come from. It could have been anything. I don't think any of us really do know if it was Maddie. We don't know if it was Russell O'Brien's daughter, because his daughter was of a similar age. She was 3 months difference in age. She had the same similar color hair as Maddie. And in actual fact, Matt and Rachel were staying at the apartment next door to the McCanns. And Rachel claims that one night, Russell and Jane's daughter was there having a bath. Now, why? This is one little thing, one little snippet that popped out of her statement, which not a lot of people realize, that what is Rachel doing giving a bath to Russell and Jane's daughter if they weren't looking after them? I mean, it just doesn't fit. But the fact that they were directly underneath Mrs. Fenn, to me, there's always the possibility that Mrs. Fenn heard Ella. I'm not saying she did, but, you know, take everything into consideration. You cannot guarantee that crying was Maddie. It may very well have been, sadly, but we don't know. So I do have a video of that, but I'm not sure that Maureen has that one. Do you? Maureen? Calling Maureen.
I'm here. Which video was it you wanted?
So did you upload the crying video? Never mind. Do you know what? Never mind. Don't worry about it, because all of these videos, like I said, are on the WordPress page, and you can pop back and just scroll down and you can see it for yourself. A lot of what I've said, I'm sure, is going over everybody's head. Excuse me. And that's okay. I can only tell you what I learned, and it is so confusing. And maybe as once you hear it and start to see that there were discrepancies, that if it makes you question and look back and see, then that's worthwhile to me. So now we've always she heard, and then at one point she heard the patio doors close. This is an hour and a quarter afterwards. And then the crying stopped. Now, we can't take for, we don't know if they were going in or out. You know, was something happening for that 3/4 of an hour that made one of the children cry? And then something happened and they left the apartment? Or was the child crying and somebody came in the apartment and the child immediately stopped? We just don't know. I do have a video clip of the hairdresser of Mrs. Fenn, the one who heard the crying, and she apparently, and this is just speculation, not speculation, but this is gossip, whatever, it's not from the files, it's not confirmed, but I thought it was worthwhile keeping what this hairdresser actually said about what Mrs. Fenn had told her about that night. Do you have that one handy, Maureen?
I did, but I don't know where it's gone. There's something happening with StreamYard.
No problem. Don't worry.
I uploaded the call earlier today.
Mrs. Fenn told the hairdresser. Yeah, it's okay if you don't have it. No big deal.
I don't know whether they have
the hairdresser
to meet them.
Don't worry, Maureen. No big deal. So this Mrs. Fenn had apparently told this hairdresser that on the Tuesday night, the McCanns were the child was crying for an hour and a quarter, and the McCanns had apparently gone to Chaplin's, one of the other bars in the area. Now, we know that they went to the Tapas Bar, which was situated just the other side of the pool in the complex. But that doesn't mean that at 10 o'clock at night, they might have moved to Chaplin's. These are all things that we don't know. I'm just telling you what the hairdresser claimed. So don't take it as gospel, just it's a thought. It's the kind of stuff that you retain in your head in case it fits later. So now we get to Wednesday morning. Now, this is a day later, and since I wrote this blog, I discovered some other information which is really quite shocking, and I'm going to have to remember it. Now, I haven't been studying the case for a couple of years, not in detail. So I'm going to have to try and remember this from memory. But on the Wednesday morning, Jerry received some texts, and they were texts which were so important, which he denied. He denied receiving them. I think there was it 14 texts? I can't remember. But he denied them. But it was so important that after a few years or a year or so later, the Portuguese police applied to the Supreme Court, I believe, to get in contact, to find out what was in these texts. Ultimately, they were turned down. But why were they so important? And what, as I recall, the first ones arrived at, I think, about 8:15 in the morning of Wednesday morning. And curiously enough, at 7-something in the morning, Kate had received a call, or called, I can't remember which, her best friend in the UK. Now, I'm not sure if she was a nurse. I think her husband was a pathologist. Not that that means anything specific, but it was her best friend. And she called her, why, at 7:30 in the morning? And then at 8:15, approximately, Jerry started receiving the texts, which he denied. And then a short while after, and I wish I could remember exactly, but let's say approximately 8:30, Jane Tanner had some suspicious calls. So that was really, really odd for the Wednesday morning. It was raining, and so the tennis was cancelled. Diane Webster decided to go for breakfast. Jane stayed in the apartment. Now, Diane recalls seeing the McCanns at the Millennium, despite them saying they didn't go for breakfast. At some point during the Wednesday morning, the cleaner was let into their apartment. And I have the video of the cleaner. And she said that she was let into the apartment, and they let her in, and then they left by the patio doors. Didn't tell her.
That video.
She said, pardon?
I have got that video here.
Yeah, it's not such an important one because when I added the translation, it was very small text. So you can see it if you want to on the WordPress page. So she was quite surprised that they didn't tell her anything. They just left by the patio doors, and that was it. And so what happened? She made the beds and noticed that there was a cot in the McCann's bedroom. Now, that's odd because the two cots were supposed to be in Madeline's room. And you probably saw the picture of it in the video that Maureen showed at the beginning, that there was Madeline's bed, which was against the wall as you walk in to the left, and then the two cots, and there was a bed further over towards the window. But there was only two cots. But the cleaner said that there was a cot in the parents' bedroom. Now, that in itself is not a big deal, but they vehemently denied it. Now, why would they deny it? What was it that they, what reason did they not want anybody to think that they had a cot in their room? There has to be some reason. I don't know what it is, but this again is something which I have always found as important. Why would it be denied? But okay. Now, on the Wednesday around lunchtime, supposedly Kate went for a jog in her pink trainers, and she made a big deal about these pink trainers again. Why? But she went with Matthew, and apparently was bitten by a dog, causing blood on her leg. Is this a little clue of something? I can't remember if it did tell us anything. Maybe somebody who knows would be able to help on that. And it was kind of odd that she would go for a jog with Matthew at lunchtime. Now, if it was that she was grieving around that time and Matthew went, you know, that's a possibility. In the evening, what was odd was that Jerry and Russell both went to the tapas together. Now, that's not usually the case. All the friends went as couples. So Jerry and Russell arrived together, and Jez Wilkins, one of the other guests, asked where, or Jerry, without being asked, told him that Kate was putting the children to bed. He said that she didn't arrive while he was there. That's one thing, but when you think about it, where was Jane? It's one thing for Jerry to go along with Russell, but surely you'd think Jane would be there as well. But no, Jane was missing as well. Was it that she was at the apartment with Kate? Who knows? But it's a thought. And we don't know for sure that they actually were there, either Kate or Jane. So that kind of covers 2 days that Kate might not have been at the tapas. We all presume she was. Now, the tapas waiters will tell you that, yes, it was a table of nine. What a lot of people may, or the ones that have looked at the files, this is just a thought of mine. This is not a fact as such. But the police asked most of the friends, do you know the Irvins? And there was a couple of Irvin sisters that were at the resort, and nobody ever really put anything to that. Why would they be asking all the friends? Do you know the Irvin sisters? Did they come to your table? And they all said no. But when you think about it, the tapas waiters were saying, yes, there was a table, there was about nine of them. Now, is it possible that Kate and Jane weren't there, but these Irvin sisters filled that spot to make the tapas believe that everybody was at the table? It's a possibility, and it's one which, I've kept in mind, but there is no proof of that. Just odd that the police would actually ask all the tapas on that. And now apparently another thing that was very weird was that night they stayed longer. In fact, one of the waiters was, this was Wednesday night, one of the waiters was pretty upset that they wanted to leave at midnight, But the group stayed there until about 1 a.m. And that's kind of weird. It fits into what I believe, that if something had happened and they were planning something, the abduction, the fake abduction for the Thursday, that maybe this was the night that they got together without Diane Webster, because I absolutely don't believe that Diane, the mother of Fiona Payne, knew anything. And is it possible that that night a few of them got together to have a to discuss what was going to happen the next day and how they were going to deal with it or whatever? Again, I don't know, but it's very odd. And the waiter was pretty upset. Kate didn't apparently sleep with Jerry that night. And it certainly doesn't look like, when you look at the bed, certainly nobody had slept in it, even though Jerry said she was there. So again, discrepancies. Then on Thursday morning, they awoke and about 7 a.m. and apparently Madeline came into them to ask why you didn't come when the twins were crying. And that got changed. That was on the fourth. That was on the third that they apparently said that. By the 11th, they claimed it was Sean, Madeline and Sean were crying. So why did they change that? Odd. There was no reason why their statement should have changed anything after that. Rest of the day was there was Jane and Fiona claiming to have been playing tennis at the time the last picture was taken. Fiona actually claimed that the last time she saw Madeline was when Madeline was playing tennis, and yet Jane said Madeline was there while they were playing tennis, but Rachel didn't see her. So was Rachel there? Was Jane there? Was Madeline? Was the family there? I think it was very possible that nobody was there. That was the plan, to make the last picture appear credible. And then it gets into the evening. But I think at that point, I'm going to stop on that, because that was so boring, I'm sure, for most people. But I just wanted to get across how it started and how the discrepancies. Oh, and to finish off, Maureen, you do have this one. It's the interview with Kate and Jerry, where it was leaked out that the twins had been crying, or Madeline and Sean had been crying, and the McCanns denied it. And this is their BBC interview when they were asked, and Kate denies the fact that in this interview anyway. Later on, they work out they're another.
You know, you said that the night before, Madeline and Sean had been very upset.
I didn't say that, actually.
Well, that was in the statement, wasn't it, that was leaked out. Was that not the case? Was she not upset the night before and talked to you the night before?
Of not been able to do that, so I do apologize for rambling on, and I hope it if nothing else, it told you that there were some odd things happening during the week, and certainly things which shouldn't have been happening. So was there any questions?
What I'll do to give you a break, I've got the three clips here that we couldn't get up earlier. So I'll play them now, then that'll be in people's minds before you.
Morning has broken like the first morning. singing praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world. Sweet the rains new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the red garden, sprung in completeness where his feet is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden's all play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new.
I'm looking for.
I mean, I don't want to dwell on it too much. I mean, I don't know if you saw the documentary last night, so I mean, I have talked about it. Madeline made a comment in passing that, where were you when I cried? Not just to mummy, by the way, just generally. It just seemed a bit odd. I mean, it was a very kind of passing remark, and we just thought she doesn't usually wake up, and she woke up, that means that, you know, she must have fallen back asleep very quickly. And then she moved on. She moved on.
Two words for you, bestie. Eat Toro Copy Trader.
Just find a top investor on.
There we have it. Anybody
okay,
got
thanks, Maureen. Yeah, before I ask for any questions, I just want to say, Chris, I got your name wrong. It was Kim and Chris that is the reason that you've all had to put up with me. I'm dedicating it to them because they are such huge, huge fans of Madeline Case, and I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for them. So, and I think that was a long and possibly without any interruptions, without the videos in between, was possibly a very long and difficult to listen to.
No, it wasn't.
Thing, but from now on, basically, I would like it to be more interactive and to answer questions and things like that. I just wanted to get that week down so that people who are not familiar with the case had an idea. And I hope somewhere, I don't know how you managed to stay, those of you that are still here, because I know I couldn't. Anyway, carry on, Maureen.
Right, if anybody's got any questions.
Okay, Carrie, if your child woke up while you were not there, you wouldn't leave them alone again. Then again, I'm sure no one here would leave their kids anyway. Yeah?
All children wake up.
Did you say something?
Sometimes.
Yeah, and that's.
So there were a couple questions throughout your talking.
Yeah.
Yeah, I did.
I just want to address the neglect issues. Is that if you take into consideration, and if you are of the belief that there was possibly something happened to Maddie earlier in the week. Maddie wasn't there in that room that night. There was no neglect. And there was only 5 minutes of that night where all of the tapas nine were at the table. Only 5 minutes. So for the rest of the time during that night, somebody was back at the apartment. So there was probably no possibility of them no possibility of them being left alone. Somebody was looking after them. So I don't believe there was neglect. I believe that something had happened by this Thursday night and Maddie wasn't in the apartment at that point. And so there wasn't neglect. But they did have to say neglect because neglect, if there's no neglect, there could be no abduction. And I think they really needed to make it sure, as I mentioned before, Jerry was going around telling everybody that they were leaving the children alone. And I think that needed to be known because how could they have an abduction if the children weren't left alone? So no neglect, no abduction. So hopefully that answers it.
Lizzie?
And what were you saying, Shirley? I'm sorry.
Sorry, So a little bit ago, somebody asked a question. Were they in the chaplain's bar on Tuesday?
Well, this we don't know. I mean, we don't know. We've got 40,000 files. And most people think that's exactly what happened during that week. This is everything. But we all know that the 40,000 files are just the official details that have been put into emails and statements and everything else. Think of the thousands and thousands and thousands of other hours where the police intelligence were there, which they didn't make notes or put into the official files. I think a lot of people forget that, you know, that just thousands and thousands of hours that we don't know about. We just know the official. There was nothing official to say that they were at Chaplin's, only that's why I told you about the clip of the hairdresser saying that this is what Mrs. Fenn said, and there's nothing proven. So it's just a thought, which is possible, but I wouldn't like to say it's true.
Okay, another question, and I just have three of them from way back, so.
Back when I was pregnant, eh?
Well, no, I mean, that's kind of the point. So is it possible that Maddie died on Tuesday, and what do you think they did with her body?
Okay, that's a longer story. I don't know when she died. I have never claimed that she died on any specific day. When I go over my research and look at all the statements and put them into a timeline, all the discrepancies started on Tuesday morning. Now that tells me that they were trying to hide something by Tuesday. Now, was Maddie sick? She could have died Thursday. I don't know. If in fact she died, it could have been Thursday. But the point is that if it was, let's say the Monday before the Tuesday, Sunday or Monday before the Tuesday, that gave, for one thing, that gave time for Kate to grieve, because I don't believe for a second that the way Kate was supposedly acting that night was a grieving mother. I mean, yes, she was of course grieving, but I think it wasn't an immediate grief. I cannot see in the 3/4 of an hour that Jerry would get to the apartment, he would figure out what they were going to do, he would get rid of Maddie's body and get back to the tapas, tell everybody what happened and arrange. It just was not enough time. But if something had happened to Maddie on the Monday, let's say, and whatever day, if she was fatally ill and it was very likely just an accident, I don't think anybody has ever claimed that they killed her. That I don't believe at all. I think something happened and it was an accident. And if that was the case, then they'd have to think about what they were going to plan. And if they planned the abduction, first of all, they would have to find a way to keep her body from where were they going to put her. The one thing that Gonzalo Amaral was the chief coordinator for the case. He was the chief coordinator for Southern Portugal. He wasn't just on this case. He was the lead for Southern Portugal. So every case in Southern Portugal, he was in charge of. But of course, that because this happened in Southern Portugal, he was in charge of this case. And before anybody ever questions the police, I will get to the police, and they were absolutely on the ball. Don't ever listen to anybody saying that the police were no good. That was something that Jerry and Kate McCann started from the start to try and convince everybody that the police were no good. Because when the police come up with facts, it meant that everybody thinks, oh, well, the police were no good. But anyway, so if something happened to Maddie during that week, let's say it was the Monday, then it doesn't go without saying that they could have taken her body, and from the cadaver dog alerts, we know that there was blood on the tiles, which matched the components of Madeleine McCann in the apartment. We know that the cadaver dog also alerted in that same spot behind the sofa. We know that the cadaver dog alerted in the corner of the McCann's bedroom. It doesn't mean that she was actually in the cupboard, because cadaver odor just gets into one area. There's no specific place. But then from there was also cadaver odor on the balcony, on the veranda, because their bedroom had doors, veranda doors. And not a lot of people are aware, the actual dogs came back a second time. We've only seen the dogs videoed on the day that they discovered the blood. On, I think, the 4th of August, the dogs came back, and that's when they alerted to the blood under the tiles. And you may have heard that the dogs found Maddie's blood under the tiles. That was not the case. The dogs found the blood of the officer that lifted the tiles. Lino, I think his name was. So if you ever hear that Maddie's blood was found under the tiles, that is not the case. Her blood was on top of the tiles. And so the cadaver dog also alerted out into the veranda. This was not in the initial video that you see of the dogs, because it happened a couple of days later. And the dogs also alerted to hares on the balcony. And those hares were sent to, not to the British FSS, but they were sent to Portugal. I've searched and searched and searched to try and find out the results of those hares, but there were hares and there was cadaver odor on the veranda. And that's in the files. And then from the veranda, the cadaver dog alerts to the garden area below the veranda, not in another area, right below the veranda. And that tells me that there's a possibility that she was taken from the lounge into the bedroom, back through the patio doors onto the veranda and down to the garden below, and then possibly taken off at a suitable time in a car. This is all possibility. This is working out a scenario, maybe based on those facts. I cannot guarantee, but Gonzalo Amaral, the coordinator, has mentioned about an apartment very nearby, and he's alluded to the fact that they had a freezer there. Or did they have a freezer? He said, we will never know. But he's stated that in the blood, when the car, when the dogs were sent to the car, they did pick up blood from the car, and 15 of 19 of Madeleine Zellel's were there, along with others, but it wasn't that there was only 19 and 15 of them were Madeleine's. It was, I think, about 30 alleles were there, but 15 of Madeleine's 19 alleles were there. It's slightly different than saying it was only 19 and 15 were Madeleine, so it must have been Madeleine. There were others there. But also, what he has stated is that there was fluid leaked out from under the trunk onto the wheel and onto the curb. Now, keep it in mind, translations can change. I don't know that he means a curb of a road or whatever, but he does state that there was fluid, that body fluid that leaked out over the curb, and it can't be explained except that there was a body in there that was frozen and possibly was moved in the car. And so this is what may have happened, is that if it had happened in the week, they moved the body, moved it to an apartment with a freezer, as Gonzalo Amaral has alluded to, and maybe at some other time, which I believe happened, is they moved it to another location. Because on the 28th of July, they made several trips to the Triangle area for an hour a night, on like the 25th to the 28th. And on the 28th, which was a couple of days before the dogs were brought in, they never went back there again. And I thought there is a strong possibility that maybe she was moved at some point to the old Triangle area and was finally moved before the dogs came in on the 28th of July. I don't know, but that's a possibility. And if that's the case, the dogs came in, and that's when they found the, they alerted in the apartment and at the car. Now, they didn't alert to anywhere else, none of the friends' apartments. There was 17 alerts altogether, and every single one of the alerts was to something belonging to the McCanns. Their clothes, Kate's clothes, a little red T-shirt that belonged to Sean. At least he was wearing it. And curiously enough, here's another little snippet that I discovered, was that I have a picture of him, I'm not sure when, maybe June sometime, of him wearing the red T-shirt that was alerted to by the cadaver dog. On that day, Jerry had written in his blog about Sean and the sea bass, eating sea bass. And from what we understand, sea bass gives out a cadaver odor. Now, is there some connection that Jerry, in his blog in June or whenever, was claiming that Sean had sea bass to cover any possibility that cadaver odor would be on Sean's T-shirt? Because Sean was wearing the T-shirt that day. I don't know. That's just something I connected as a possibility. So that's what basically I feel happened. Something happened to Maddie. They took her body, possibly put it in a freezer, and then moved it over to possibly the Triangle. We know that they claimed that in the end of July, that a neighbor, when by this time they were staying in the villa, a neighbor had seen the car. It was at the end of a close, like a cul-de-sac maybe. They had seen the car every night with the trunk open as though they were airing it out. And Jerry's brother-in-law had claimed that they'd bought meat and it had spilled out into the car, and that's why they'd left the trunk open. And that was at the end of July. So it's very suspicious, you know, and if that was after the time that they'd moved Maddie's body, if she had been put somewhere and it was a hot day and Gonzalo had claimed that it fluids had leaked. Does that answer that? So I know that was a long explanation, but I've got so much inside of me to explain. This case takes you in so many directions.
Yeah,
it's hard to, and it's probably too overwhelming for anybody just learning it. Hopefully those that have studied it can somewhere along the line pick up little snippets that maybe, oh, no, not thought of that. You know, it just depends. So was there another question, Shirley?
Yep, there's a couple more. So one was, does Lizzie think Maddie was sedated and it went wrong?
That I don't know. One thing I've never tried to do is find out how she died. I don't. It's not in the files. We don't know. And I've stayed away from ever trying to find out how she died. Now, it's suggested that she got up. She was sedated and got up and sat, knelt on the back of the settee next to the window and fell down and hurt herself, maybe died. But that's Gonzalo Amaral's theory that he lets us know. Now, keep in mind, he can only let us know what we are allowed to know. If they have other information, he can't tell them. He uses witnesses and says, well, so-and-so was the last person to see her. But the point is, he cannot say any different. Even if that witness was lying, he'd still have to claim that that witness was telling the truth. So I think there's so much more that they know, which we don't. And from what I understand, they don't even suspect that something happened earlier. But then it took me 4 years to discover this. And I'm sending this to the PJ. I do have a contact that I can send it to, and they do have English, and I do speak English, and I hope they have patience. And who knows, maybe they'll hear something that I've come up with independently. Maybe not, but the point is, I think this information needs to be known, because everything I've told you, there is a link to prove, to show you where I got that information from. And I think that's important. And that's basically what I've done the whole time I've worked on the case. It's not anything. The only speculation is not so much speculation, but it's to look at a scenario and think, could this have been, you know, from the scenario that exists there. And a lot of times, Gonzalo will tell us stuff which isn't in the files, but I believe, being the coordinator of the case, that he does know things that we will never know. So it often follows with what he says. So was that, is there another one?
Yep. Why would the seven friends cover for them if they had done something to their child? I mean, I guess this juror number four is asking your opinion on that.
Well, I think we've all thought that from the start. If you're on holiday with your friends and something happens to your child and it's an accident, then you'd claim it as an accident. But something did happen to her, in my opinion, there's no question. The police files claim Madeline died in the apartment, the parents hid her body, and the parents simulated an abduction. This is not anything that I am claiming for myself. I'm just confirming how I came up with that. But the point is that if it was an accident, just a plain accident, there was probably no reason for them to hide it, and they would have come out and said about it. But there was a reason. We don't know the reason, don't want to get into details about what might be the reason, but there was a reason that they didn't want it known. And when you think about it, it's not even presumed that the McCanns were actually involved in this. If somebody was watching the children, and let's take one example of a possibility. Let's say one of the friends, they'd all decided that one of them would stay behind and watch the children. And in actual fact, I think Paulo Ribello went back after Gonzalo Amaral was removed from the case. And he did very probably, although it's not directly known, but he very probably is believed to have said that there were seven children. Was it seven? Whatever. Children in the apartment. And was it because they were being looked after in that one apartment? But if you think about it as a scenario, supposing one of them was looking after all the children in one apartment, and supposing they were using Calpol, which was suggested, it was a nighttime medicine for children. At that time, it was not one that people were, it was taken off the market shortly after that because of issues with it. But let's say if one of the tapas was there looking after the children in the apartment, which may be a reason why the cleaner claimed that there was bed in the McCann's room. Maybe, you know, all the children were separated into the two rooms or the three rooms. That could be an answer why the bed was in the McCann's room. But anyway, if that was the case, and supposing that maybe, let's say Maddie had already been given a sedation, and the person that was looking after them decided to give her, not knowing that she'd already had some. You know, I mean, there's a multitude of scenarios about what might have happened, but if that was the case, how on earth could they pinpoint that one person? They'd have to all get together and say, you know what, we'll all take this. We're not going to just throw you to the wolves. We'll all just say this, this, this. So basically all of them would know. And I think there may have been something where Maddie was tried to be resuscitated, because Rachel, in one of her statements, did claim, well, if we'd have resuscitated her, then we were all doctors, or they were all doctors. Like, why use that word if something hadn't happened in that, you know, of that nature? But yeah, I think in that case, they would all feel obliged to keep it quiet, because one of them, not necessarily just the McCanns, one of them had kind of been accidentally responsible. I don't know. It's just a scenario that could be possible, something of that nature. But I do believe they all did know, because they were all making just contradictions right the way through the holiday. And only Diane Webster, I believe, didn't know. And that is, I believe, because also confirmed with the fact that on the Wednesday night, when they stayed till 1 o'clock in the morning, that it would have been after Diane had left, you know, because they didn't have a lot of other time to speak all together to figure out what was going to happen. I don't know. Maybe that's a possibility. So, yes, I think there is, there could be a reason that they all had to know, because it wasn't just a plain accident.
Mm-hmm.
So, Lizzie, another question is, do you think the new DNA techniques would make a difference to the evidence? And to add on to that, because I don't know much about this case, is there DNA evidence that they could still test?
There is an absolute great podcast that I really recommend. Rather than listen to me, I would, which is a bit late now, maybe, I would absolutely recommend that Mark Saunokonoko from Nine News in Australia did a 13-week podcast, I believe, and he is absolutely an investigative journalist who discovered things which and spoke to DNA forensic specialists who were actually willing to go and recheck with today's abilities, and offered to have everything done with at no charge, and nobody has taken them up on it. And they're really, amazing scientists that have offered this. This isn't just anybody, but I do recommend Mark's podcast. It was last year, and he was nice enough to recognize the fact that myself and Cherry and Helen and Carrie had helped him over. We helped him, I think, over the course of 2 years, along with Isabel and also Ben Salmon. We had all helped him with this podcast, and it was lovely that he recognized us in the credits at the end. But it's worth listening to that, I think, because yes, there have been new developments, and yes, Gonzalo Amaral has mentioned about the hairs, and at the time it wasn't possible to tell whether or not they were from a dead body or not, but now they can. So these hairs, which were found on the veranda, never mind that supposedly there were hairs in the car, but we don't know that for sure. But certainly the hairs on the veranda would be with the Portuguese, and they would be able to get some information from there. And as far as the case goes, what we have to remember is that as far as we know, police have all the evidence they need. They just can't charge anybody until they have a body or somebody confesses. And they've said that that's the only two scenarios where they can actually charge somebody at this point. So I believe they have all the evidence they need. They just don't have a body, and they don't, who knows, there may be a confession one day. I don't know. So yes, the DNA has progressed to the point that they could tell. It's been offered for it to them to retest from another area as opposed to the Birmingham FSS. They haven't taken them up on it. I'm hoping that they do have all the details already. And but Mark is absolutely, you must listen to it. It's a great podcast.
So well, thank you. More? I don't think there is any more questions, actually. We have agreed to keep these Saturday night ones to 90 minutes because the detail is so intense. If you go longer than that, you tend to lose what you've heard tonight. So we're keeping them to around about 90 minutes, to be fair on Lizzie, because it's a long while to talk.
Maureen,
and I promise next week the videos will be better.
Maureen?
Yes?
Maureen?
Yeah.
I think it's more that we need to keep it to an hour and 30 minutes or less, because who wants to listen to me for an hour and 30 minutes? This is why didn't want to do it.
No, you are. That's why I haven't said a lot, because I have actually been listening to you. And I'm just thinking, when you fill someone's head with a lot of information for too long, you do tend to forget a little bit. And I feel to keep them like to the 90 minutes, like we said, it's enough to take in and remember. So when you pick up again next week, you won't have forgotten what you heard tonight.
Oh, I think most people would forget a lot. The people are not overly familiar with it, and rightly so. That was a tremendous amount of information to take in all in one go. And I'm not professional at doing it. I'm not. I don't have all the resources to say, okay, this is what I should do and this is what I shouldn't do. I just know what I know, and I try and kept it within the first few days of the holiday, just to give the very basics. And then after that, I've got lots of weeks of topics that really can look at different scenarios of how they how it happened, what just amazing discrepancies and what makes us believe that something happened to Maddie earlier in the week. It's just too much.
Lizzie?
Yes?
There's a comment, or there's a question up on the screen from Pony. He said, would a human body give off a scent if it has been frozen?
I'm sorry, would a body give off a scent if what?
If it has been frozen.
I'm sure cadaver dogs are just absolutely incredible. They can discover blood that is 100 years old. There is one video that I have which is totally incredible. It's not the cadaver dogs that we used in the Maddie case, but it was there was a case somewhere in the States where a chap went missing and they just happened to bring in these cadaver dogs. And there was three lots of ladies that had these dogs, and all three of these dogs alerted in one place. And it was they got the tipper thing, you know, that digs, don't know what it's called. And they dug down and the dogs were alerting, and they finally got to a whole slew of meat. And this was quite deep down, but that wasn't what the dogs were alerting to. The dogs were alerting to a body that was underneath the meat, and this was 10 foot down. I mean, the meat was obviously put there to try and distract from ever knowing that there was a dead body underneath. But this chap was rolled up in, I think, in a carpet. It's unbelievable to see. You know, they dug away and dug away, and 10 foot down underneath a pile of meat was this body. Unbelievable. I mean, nobody would ever have found that if it wasn't for these three cadaver dogs that worked together and all alerted. Amazing. So cadaver dogs can do far more than anybody could probably ever know. And I'm sure if it's frozen or not, it still has the scent. And I'm sure there's one guest, I think, that I know of, that if anybody was interested in cadaver dogs, I'm sure he would pop in to give some information on them. So, you know, that would be another week. So unless there's any more questions.
Can I just ask one more, Lizzie?
Pardon?
I just have one more, and this was for my own personal. I saw that somebody had posted a comment under one of your videos saying that Portugal has a 15-year limit to bring murder charges. So if they don't find anything in the next couple of years, then basically they got away with it, even if they admitted or whatever.
I'm not sure. I haven't seen that, so I can't dispute it. I do know that if the
I heard it, but I've never seen nothing to prove it.
Yeah, I haven't checked into it. What I do know is that once they charge somebody, they can only take eight or nine months before they have to, or if they make one of the suspects arguidos, it's about 7 or 8 months that they can do that. Then they either have to charge them or close the case. And in the McCann's case, they were made arguidos. They were given an extension, and I think it worked out to 15 months. And at that point, that's when they had to not close the case, but that's when they had to release the files. It doesn't mean that the McCanns were no longer suspects. It means that it was just law. And when it was, I think, reopened again a short time after, they're not necessarily those arguidos again, although we don't really know on that. Nothing was ever, it could be that they are arguidos. No, it wouldn't, because it would only last for 15 months. But no, so they were taken and made our Guidos and suspects. I mean, I don't know if anybody's seen that video of them. It's quite shocking to think that people cannot even comprehend the fact that they might be involved. They were made suspects. So at least take that into consideration. And as for the German bloke, well, he's, I don't even bother looking at news articles or read anything about him, because as far as I'm concerned, he is just being used. You know, as the police say, she died in the apartment, the parents hid her body, and they simulated the abduction. And that's what the police believe. So I'm totally, total respect for the Portuguese police, and totally back them on that. So I guess I should wind up for a bit now, because
I'm not kind of come to the end now for tonight.
Yeah, that's good. I was talking to Isabel McFadden.
Yeah,
and she is absolutely great on the case. She's Portuguese but lives in the States, and she was sad that she couldn't make it tonight, and so am I, because she really is great. But I think she may be able to join us possibly next week.
That's brilliant.
And maybe you can hear more from her than you do from me, because this is not this is nothing I planned. But Chris and Kim, once again, I apologize for calling you Jim. It was Chris and Kim. It's for you that I'm doing this. So, and thank you, Maureen, for giving me the opportunity to do it.
Thank you.
It's something else. So I appreciate it. And thanks, everybody, for tolerating me. Honestly, I woke up last week thinking, no, I can't do that anymore. And here I am. So I'll blame it on Chris. It's his fault. So anyway.
So I thank everybody for coming. And each week at the end of the show, we're going to feature and promote three Facebook groups, three different ones each week. So we'll play out with the video and see you all again next week.